Welcome to SAS Global Forum 2020 and this demonstration entitled Application, Authentication, and Authorization, Identity Theft Protection Across the Customer Journey. My name is John Watkins, and I'm an advisory industry consultant and the global lead for identity and digital fraud for SAS's Fraud and Security Intelligence Division. With the explosion of fraud into the digital space and the shift to identity, it's imperative to address the legitimacy of a customer's identity upfront and in real time. We'll discuss the need for both internal and external contextual data in real time and how SAS's new offering, SAS Identity Enrichment and Assessment, can help bring it all together. So in this ever-changing environment, it's critical now to make sure that you're protected right up front in real time, validating that the identity presented to you is authentic. Keep them out of your ecosystem. So how do you do that? As with any problem, it starts with the data. Getting the right contextual data at the right time, right up front, where you can make the initial decision. So how we focus on that is by leveraging a real-time cloud-based environment that provides a broad and flexible ecosystem to bring that enriched contextual information in real time to make those decisions. Now, this could be internal information, or it could be information from third-party vendors across a broad spectrum of different types of information. And some of those are represented here. The first piece may be the digital identity, to understand the device that's being presented, whether it's a laptop or a phone or iDevice, to understand how's that device been used before. How has that person used that device? What is the reputation of that device out on the internet? Second piece of it may be around biometrics. What's going on that device? What are the keystrokes? What are the mouse movements? Are there indicators that this may be some type of robotic automation that's coming in, approaching your company? The third piece of it is around authentication. What do you know about the personal information that's being presented to you? How do you go outside of the typical bureau information to understand the name, address, the phone number? Does this really match the person's true personal information? What do you know about the phone number? Does that cell phone really belong to that person? How long have they had that relationship? And potentially has that cell phone been ported? Email information. Does that email correlate to that person, or is this a burner email that they've picked up recently? And then finally, machine learning is critical in this. Whether it's leveraging SAS models or vendors that specialize in this type of modeling, this is an open, inviting environment that companies can bring either their own vendors or they can leverage SAS to bring in that type of machine learning. From a discovery standpoint, the consolidated data model allows for real-time processing and allows for real-time machine learning to take place consolidated on one platform. And a broad variety of those machine learning capabilities are available on the platform, whether it's supervised, whether regression type models or classification type models, unsupervised learning, or entity resolution and network analytics. All is available in real time to help make those decisions. And then finally, leveraging the robust SAS fraud capabilities that have been honed on the transactional fraud side, bringing those rule capabilities on a proven, scalable platform, bringing that speed to market, being able to develop and deploy rules in hours rather than days, in a cloud-based offering that can be delivered quickly in weeks rather than months, allowing the customer to be able to reduce friction for their customers and reduce fraud losses. So let's take a look at how we will put that into action. This is a web page that represents a typical application form for a financial institution or a insurance company, anyone who has a web presence and are taking applications on the internet. So it's capturing information, typical personal information like your name, address, city, state, zip, email, social security number, date of birth, etc. As you notice over here on the right, you see information that's streaming. This information is being captured as soon as the web page loaded, about the device that loaded the web page, as well as things like my mouse movement and other digital biometrics that are occurring based off my interaction with the device. So this is information that will be retrieved from the web page and will be sent over to our servers. That information will then be sent out to multiple different data providers in real time, requesting information being sent back about the device, about the personal information, brought back into the SAS identity management system, then processed, brought into one consolidated data model, and run through a series of rules to make a risk-based decision on whether or not this is a good customer or not. So we're going to go ahead and pre-populate a persona. This could be Mr. Joseph Hudson at 1000 Ravenwood Drive in Raleigh, North Carolina. So let's go ahead and submit an application and see what we know about Mr. Hudson. All right, so this came back as approved with no significant risk conditions detected. So let's look at some of the information that we got back from him. Let's start with our digital identity provider. So understand, so this is right outside of Raleigh in Cary, North Carolina. He came back, his device as a pass. This created a cookie-based device ID that sits on his laptop, but also set a fuzzy ID that's based off his device core, brought all sorts of information in that set up a non-cookie-based ID. Trusted device, he's running a Chrome browser with Windows 10, screen resolution of 1920. Believe it or not, this is a very predictive element, screen resolution. Bots don't really care about screen resolution. All sorts of information about how this device has been seen and information around the network. We'll look over, this information is brought back in real time through JSONs. You look at the response time here, all of them in the 200 millisecond range. A little bit of lag there with the BioCatch data. Let's take a look at what we had here. This is looking at the digital biometrics. Overall, pretty good rating. It's picking up that this was a long session for my laptop, so I've been logged in a while, so it did pick that up. So slightly elevated score based off my demo here, but nothing to worry about. Let's look over at Secure, which gave us back information about, first of all, we'll start with the KYC information. Name, city, state, zip, social, all matched. Very strong correlation to name and email, name and phone number. Very low email risk and phone risk. So Mr. Hudson looks like a good guy. So let's take a look at another persona here. This is going to be Mr. Boris Hansen. And let's take a look at what he brings us. Oh my, Mr. Boris declined here. So KYC fails. Let's jump right on over here and look and see what were some of the issues here. So looks like the basic KYC matched here, but he had a 99 on the fraud score. So his initial evaluation, we've got some challenges here. Let's look deep into those. So his name and email correlation. So his name and email didn't match. His name and phone didn't match. So we'll dig deeper into the email risk. So the registered name doesn't match the input name. This is a high risk email. It's an auto-generated, so this was a burner email, looks like. Also on the phone, the name doesn't match the phone, and this phone line was in service for less than 7 days. So potentially this is a prepaid that was just picked up. So from a risk standpoint, this is probably someone that you're going to queue out and validate. While his name and all of his typical KYC information will match, he's trying to hide something. His contact information does not match, and this is a good person that you're going to want to evaluate. So let's go back over here and let's look one more time at Mr. Hudson. So we'll bring him on. And let's pretend that we're working from a spreadsheet. We're a crook that has a list of his accounts that he needs to work through. So he is copying and pasting from that spreadsheet, which is what crooks do. They sit there in a room and work their spreadsheet that their boss gave them, and they'll go through and load these accounts. So we're going to submit this application. Now, you notice this person was approved earlier. Now they're declined. Device biometrics, high risk, expert keystrokes, anomalies. Let's look back over here at BioCatch. Let's actually look at the JSON they sent us back here. criminal behavior detected, expert user, low familiarity, elevated risk score based off of this. So based off of our rules, we detect these expert keystrokes. This is someone that we'd want to review based off of their activity here. So as you see, the value of the different data sources in real time, the broad variety of information, and the ability to combine these to make multiple risk-based decisions right up front. So that concludes our demonstration. I'd like to thank everyone for their time and hope you enjoyed this discussion around authentication and identity fraud and this demonstration of SAS Identity Enrichment and Assessment. If you have any questions, my email is above, and you can find more details at sas.com/fraud under Identity and Digital Fraud. Thank you, and have a wonderful day.